the QR token or QR conjugate, let's say, two vectors have this kind of product zero.
But geometrically, what does it mean if two vectors are QR orthogonal? We know that.
What does it mean geometrically? It's for you. It's algebraic for a moment. You can think geometrically. If matrix Q transforms vector Y with Q Y as Q Y and X will be orthogonal in the usual sense, it's not important now.
Okay.
Let postpone this question also. Maybe you will rethink and give us some insight after we will discuss the method. Meantime, it's just formally we have such. We have possibility to get such Q orthogonal vectors by Gram-Schmidt procedure. And then we are diving into optimization problem and find that it is very useful. If we want to minimize quadratic function, and somebody gave us a system of Q orthogonal vectors, interestingly, we can get to minimum just doing n one-dimensional optimizations. And this is demonstrated here. I don't know how in details should I return to this. At least this term is Q norm squared of vector S. And if I have decomposition of vector in orthogonal basis, the norm is just sum of squares of norm of coefficients. If it would be orthonormal, it would be just sum of square of norm of coefficients. But if the components have some norm, it's convenient for us to keep it them non-normalized. So we have this kind of expression. So we have a sum of terms as function of alpha of we changed our coordinates. Instead of x or s, we are using now alpha decomposition coefficients in this Q orthogonal basis. And as function of alpha, it's very easy to minimize because it's sum of terms and each of them only depends on its own alpha, so we can analytically do it. Okay. What question?
The quadratic problem that is given to us, is it every problem? We can phrase it in this way, that we have an x and a q that is orthogonal, or is it a special case?
If you have a problem with q symmetric positive definite, then this is rather general. If quadratic, assume we have convex, strictly convex quadratic function with Q positive definite. If it is so, then it's
then
very general.
Then I can use this.
Yes. And it's really a method of choice. If you want to minimize convex quadratic function, the best you can try first is conjugate gradient.
But this method is based if our problem is close enough to quadratic form, right? If it's not close...
We just think about quadratic problem.
Yeah, but if I...
We're not thinking about nonlinear problem at this point.
It will not
We forget. We will discuss it, but later. Now we are thinking that we are given quadratic problem and want to find this thing. Okay. Then it's just set of one-dimensional minimizations, or in other words, one can see, if look carefully, we just minimize our entire quadratic function first in direction d1, then at the point when we are after first line search, we minimize in direction d2, and so on, and finally we get to this. Okay. And related to this, very important expanding manifold property, because this sum is separable. When we do the second minimization, we don't damage the first one. So after two steps, we get minimum of our function over affine subspace spanned by D1 and D2. And this is expanding manifold. It will increase until it reaches full state, full space. And this is very important because if I have a minimum of my function over this manifold, over this manifold, that in every direction which I can move in this manifold, my gradient should be zero. So my directional derivative should be zero. It says that our gradient at new point is orthogonal to this manifold. It's orthogonal to all previous vectors. And this is a partial answer to the question which was asked, whether gradients are linearly independent. It's orthogonal to everything which was until now. We will return to this once more, but at least it's like first idea. Best hint that it is possible. Yes. If I have wow, everything is open. Maybe it's a good idea to use the method. Okay. First of all, if I am staying at some point x, and I move along the direction, and I think that along this direction I cannot improve my function, then it should be directional derivative of my function in this direction should be zero. Otherwise, I would be able to move a little bit in the direction where negative direction of directional derivative. For example, if directional derivative here is negative, I move a little bit here, and I decrease my objective function. So directional derivative should be zero. But directional derivative, it's if I have some direction d, for example, and this is gradient, directional derivative is inner product of gradient with direction, if you want second lecture. So if I want directional derivative to be zero, inner product of gradient with this direction should be zero. And now I am expanding my thinking. If I have a plane and my gradient is orthogonal to every vector in this plane, to every direction in this plane, then my gradient is orthogonal to the plane itself. Yes. Okay. And this is very important. Okay. I'm just looking at time. And then we say, if we go to the same principle, but we are not given already set of direction P or also already conjugate, but we go step by step, starting with gradient. Then we get to the conjugate gradient method. So we minimize again this quadratic function. We are staying in the point x naught and go in the direction of minus gradient. and do exact minimization. This is, will be our first conjugate derivation. Do exact line search. For quadratic function, we can do it analytically. Very straightforward. And then we compute new gradient. So we have old direction and new gradient. Instead of new gradient, we compute q orthogonal vector to old direction based on Gram-Schmidt procedure, which is written here. And that's all. All other stuff is simplifications. And we have here this expanding manifold property. After two optimizations, like we told, we achieve minimum over subspace of two phase direction. Our new gradient will be orthogonal to the previous directions and to previous gradients. So it will not be linearly dependent, it will be linearly independent. It will be orthogonal, by the way, in usual sense, not Q orthogonal, but orthogonal in usual sense, but at least this guarantees us linear independence. If orthogonal, even in usual space, it's linearly independent on previous.
But all of these methods are only for a formula of this sort.
For quadratic functions, we usually start with quadratic functions. Then, at some point, we will say magic words. We have nonlinear functions, we hope that locally, when we zoom on it with a large microscope around minimum, it will look like quadratic. And it is so. If I have a function, I don't know, cosine x, and in the origin, I will zoom. And next to it, I will drive parabola, which has the same second derivative in the beginning. Minus cosine. Cosine is this way. Yes. You will see that it will really coincide with parabola when zoom is strong enough.
So these are ways to solve the Newton method. Because the Newton method, we get a quadratic function that simulates our function, and then we find
You can think that it's close ideas. We deal with quadratic function with hope that it is close to our origin. Okay, and then we just do a couple of simplifications, and we discover that all terms of this sum disappear except of the last one. And the formula become really simple. The formula will become that new direction is it's all direction multiplied by some multiplier minus new gradient. And the formula for beta case are two formulas which are equivalent in quadratic case, because what we have in numerator gk plus 1, it's actually orthogonal to gk, again because of expanding manifold. But if it happens, then if we will try mechanically apply this procedure to non-quadratic function, this kind of formula have some self-correcting properties. I mean, despite that it's not exactly following real conjugate gradient because of non-quadraticity, it somehow correcting itself and behaves better. So the final procedure is rather simple. We first go in direction of minus gradient, do line search, compute new gradient, compute new direction by this formula, and then go back to the line search. We loop here, I don't show the loop, shorten notation, but actually loop among those three lines. And if we are aware that function is really quadratic, we can perform line search in analytic way, which is written here. And also we can save on computation. We will discover that in calculation of gradient you need multiply q by new x, which is q by old x minus q by direction. Actually, every iteration we only need to compute qd, which is a significant saving. We reduce the amount of computation by factor 2. Okay, this is basic part of contribute gradient. This may be good time for discussion, good times. Okay, any question, any comments? And then we had one more part related to preconditioning. And we say one thing. If I have a function f of x, which Hessian has a certain condition number, I can change my variables by x is equal to some matrix S multiplied by y. And instead of minimize function phi of y, and the Hessian will be modified in this way. So if somebody tells me what is this good, this is called scaling matrix. What is good scaling matrix S in the way that Hessian will be better conditioning, then I will be happy. And if somebody told me this matrix, I can perform method or gradient descent even in these new variables. And it happens that in original variables, the formula will be very simple. We just will multiply by SS transform, where SS transpose our directions. Let me finish. And for conjugate gradient, the story is very similar. We just, instead of using gradient, we multiply in the original variables the gradients by this matrix SS transpose. And also in the formula for beta, we use the same, we call this matrix W. And formula for beta also we use this matrix. Okay, yes, now.
How do I find the suitable S matrix?
Yes, so there was a very brief discussion in the lecture. So if my Hessian is diagonal, it's obvious that S should be a 1 or square root of diagonal. But quite often I may have a matrix which is not diagonal, but diagonal terms, say, are significantly larger than other terms in the matrix. Even in this case, by this diagonal preconditioning, it's very useful. But on the other hand, you see this pay attention. We don't need actually the matrix S. It's enough to have SS transpose. So if we know inverse Hessian, it's another extreme. Yes, if I have a Hessian matrix, but I know inverse Hessian, actually, this, if I multiply it by inverse Hessian, this will give me Newton direction, which is very good. So if I am able to compute inverse Hessian, it's great. But in physical problems, quite often I don't have access to inverse Hessian, but I can invert it approximately. And this is a kind of art, omanut, lechapes, to look for good ways of compute these approximate inverses. For example, in many cases, my physical problem may be related to discretization. I have image, for example, and I pixelize it, and my variables are values in every pixels. Then instead I can compute image for more coarse grid and compute all my problem for this coarse formulation and use approximate inverse of Hessian in this low dimensional case and try for this. And I'm hand waving now. From this try to understand what will be formula for approximate inverse of Hessian on fine grid on many variables. And quite often people are able to do it. So if you open preconditioning, you will find in Google many examples from different applications people find reasonable preconditions. So this is all for our basic part, and as usually, feel free to come to me and ask any questions and continue the discussion.